Picture this. Because you've got nothing better to do, you take a stroll around the interweb and see this awesome design. You want to have it too, so you get to work on reproducing it with your 3D printer, or for that matter, pretty much any other tool you can use to create stuff. Even the humble Ctrl-C, Ctrl-V applies here. But that's where you run into it. Copyright, patents, trademark rights. Maybe you even thought your material was open source. Well, let me explain. So today I want to touch on these four topics. Copyrights for intellectual property, trademarks, patents for inventions, and while we're at it, how open source works within that ecosystem. This isn't going to be legal advice, and while a fair bit of what I'm about to show you is based on the US and European situation and should be similar in other parts of the world, there are still going to be differences from one country to the next. So let's get into it. First of all, these four topics of copyright, trademarks, patents, and open source are pretty much separate issues, and with the exception of the interplay of copyright and open source, none of these are inherently connected. Let's start with copyright, and a lot of it is in the name already. It's the exclusive right to copy an original work. That's it. Well, not quite. Copyright applies to creative work in the widest sense, such as books and articles, pictures, videos, music, sculptures, etc., and software, which is considered a literary work in the US. The scope of copyright is important to know because purely functional designs do typically not fall within the scope of copyright and can only really be protected by a patent, just like ideas and processes, and mere discoveries and unoriginal work don't get any acknowledgement as far as copyright goes at all. So, while for example I can claim copyright on my videos, the text and photos published alongside them, I cannot claim a copyright for most of my 3D designs because they don't fall under the definition of creative work as they are mostly functional, but also run into another detail of copyright law. The threshold of originality. Essentially stating that even when your work is of an artistic nature, it needs to pass a certain threshold of complexity or effort put into it to even be considered relevant for copyright at all. So while, say, Luby's dragon designs are no doubt original works of art to which copyright does apply, this simple blocky throne design might not quite pass the threshold. Actually, neither do these companies' logos, as they aren't complex enough. They are still registered trademarks though, which we'll touch on in a second. Contrary to popular belief, a creator does not need to register their work or add any sort of mark or text to their work to own the copyright on it. So basically, any image, video, music piece, design, etc. that falls into the criteria I just mentioned is essentially copyright the author, all rights reserved. And that means you can't use it. Yes, you're allowed to view it, but you can't use it on your own website, post it to Facebook, or use it on a business card. You can't integrate it into your own work or even publish modified versions. And neither a disclaimer like, I don't own the content shown here, nor attribution to the original author are magic bullets that suddenly make that okay. The US has a specialty there in the form of fair use, meaning you are allowed to use excerpts, for example, from music tracks or movies to discuss, criticize, and parody the material as long as you add your own spin. Now, the question is, how does this apply to 3D printing? Well, there's definitely a bit of discussion going on in that area, but my understanding is something like this. When you've got an original 3D design and simply print it, the resulting part is still a reproduction of that design and therefore covered under the author's copyrights. That is, considering you're looking at the design that is encapsulated in, for example, an STL file, and not just the bits and bytes of the file itself. But in either case, grabbing artsy designs, printing them, and selling them for a profit is probably not okay. And even just publishing designs based on other original content can infringe on their copyright, as, for example, the authors of a 3D printable rocket design based on the Tintin comics, and another designer who published a left shark got to know when their designs were removed from Thingiverse after a DMCA notice. However, when it comes to something like design files and electronic schematics, the current legal understanding is that while the actual drawing, for example, of a schematic is original work applicable to copyright, the actual function of the circuit is not. So while you can't redistribute and reuse the actual drawing itself, you can still make copies of the circuit and use it for your own purposes, since that's the exclusively functional portion of it, which isn't covered by copyright. And here's sort of where Creative Commons comes in. As a copyright owner, you have the choice of explicitly allowing others to use your work for free. This doesn't mean you're giving away the copyright itself, you're just giving out usage rights. Creative Commons lets you decide how and for what purpose people and companies can use the content you release. The most drastic one would be the CC0 license, or public domain, where you allow anyone to use that work in any way and for any purpose. Obviously, unless you're super religious about sharing everything, signing away all rights might be too extreme. So Creative Commons does allow you to put some conditions in place that people should follow when they use your content. Those go from having to attribute the author when his or her content is used for requiring any new content that is created from the original one to be released under a compatible license. So if the original piece is Creative Commons Attribution Share Alike, the resulting work also needs to be licensed as Creative Commons Attribution Share Alike. You could also add conditions like not allowing to modify the work or not allowing it to be used in commercial products. The last one is a bit critical because education in particular isn't clearly non-commercial, so often work with that license addendum doesn't get used where it's needed the most. These individual terms can be combined to form the various Creative Commons licenses. So to recap copyright, by default, the creator owns all rights to a creative work, so even when he or she shows or posts it publicly, it doesn't mean you can too. Unless, of course, he decides to specify a liberal license like Creative Commons that allows other people to use their work. Copyright does not apply to many 3D printable models, as they are either purely functional or don't pass the threshold of originality. But wait, there's more! Let's quickly touch on trademarks before we move on to patents. So, unlike copyright, a trademark does usually need to be registered. Its purpose is to identify who made a product, which, for example, keeps Pepsi from making a product called Coca-Cola, or even from using similar sounding names or logos on their products. Keep in mind that trademarks and copyright are mostly independent of each other. For example, the copyright on many of the earlier Mickey Mouse shorts has expired, while the character design and the name is still a trademark of the Walt Disney Company. And companies do need to enforce their trademark, or it will be considered abandoned, so don't be surprised when your flexible film and shoe design bearing those three stripes gets taken down, or even gets some snail mail from a lawyer for publishing it in the first place. Now, patents start where copyright leaves off, at least when it comes to functional designs. A registered patent will have a similar effect to copyright when it comes to principles of operation, processes, and mechanical functions. The difference being, of course, a patent needs to be registered and paid for, which will give you a maximum of 20 years of protection of your inventions. However, for those 20 years, the patent holder has the exclusive right to sell and import goods that use the technology covered by the patent. And in the same way that copyrighted things can be licensed for others to use, so can a patent, but it's usually not going to be free. Quite the opposite, actually. Patents are key factors when it comes to defending your company against patent claims from others. We've seen this in Apple versus Samsung regularly, where both parties know they are infringing on each other's patents and essentially just use the court case to figure out who should be paying whom how much money. They are also routinely used in judging how much a company is worth and can even serve as trading goods, which is where patent hoarders or patent trolls stem from. And that is because patents are hugely more powerful than copyright. They don't only apply to an exact part a manufacturer makes, but also to any other implementation somebody else works out by using the same principles. So, say you owned a patent for the process of using a heated nozzle to melt plastic and then smearing that down in layers to make an object. In that case, nobody else would be allowed to make an FDM 3D printer unless the patent holder, in that case Stratasys, allowed it. And rest assured, for those 20 years from 1989 to 2009, Stratasys definitely made sure that patent was only used where they approved. Which is also why the Repair Project got started right after the patent expired. The thing is, for a patent to be considered valid, it needs to be a considerable advancement of the state of the art, and there can't be any prior art, so you or your company actually have to be the ones inventing something new, and in theory, can't just copy someone else's prior work. And one spicy detail about patents is that, by design, they need to be public. Some companies actually don't patent their developments to keep others from using them as a blueprint and evading the patent claims by modifying a few minor details. But it looks like that the rich get richer system of patents is slowly getting a bit of a makeover. There have been some efforts to limit the power of patent trolls that only buy patents to sue others. Also, Tesla have declared that their patents will never be used to attack a competitor for using them, but only as a defense when someone else sues them over patents they might be infringing on. Elon Musk has called them open source or public domain, which technically are terms that only apply to copyright, but we get the idea. So, let's talk about open source in the context of trademarks, patents, and copyright. Because at its core, the open source term only means that you are opening up the source files of your finished product. For software, that is the source code that the program is compiled from, and for hardware, the design files, drawings, and such are typically considered the source. Though for something to be considered open source as intended, those source files need to come with a liberal license that allows universal reuse. So, for example, a Creative Commons No Derivatives or non-commercial license is often not considered a true open source license because even though the source files are public, you're still severely limited when it comes to how you can use those files. In general, someone publishing something as open source will make all files available that are needed to reproduce and modify it, and also allow that reproduction and modification to happen by attaching a liberal license. And the idea behind this is that instead of having to figure out the same things independently of each other, everyone can build on previous work and then also share their work under a liberal license for others to use. This creates an ecosystem of open source products that each have a much easier job getting to the finish line and in turn give back to the community. But keep in mind that while something can be shared with, say, a Creative Commons or GPL license, patents and trademarks of third parties are completely independent of that and might still put some restrictions on how you can use them. So while open source software is pretty much figured out with the various GPL licenses, hardware is a bit of a different story. Putting one and one together, as functional hardware isn't covered by copyright, it seems as though there wouldn't be any restrictions on copying, say, 3D printer hardware or entire machines unless they are protected by patents. Which seems counterintuitive, but after the research I've done on these topics, it seems like that is exactly the case. I might have to update my position on clone products for that. So let's recap all of this. Copyright applies to all creative work and grants the creator the exclusive right to share the work. Trademarks typically need to be registered and identify a specific product or company. Patents protect inventions and unique functional designs, and while there are valuable assets to a company, they will also expire within a given time. And lastly, open source is the idea of deliberately sharing plans of a design for others to use in their own products. Now, obviously, if I did get something wrong, let me know in the comments below. This video isn't legal advice, but a summary of the research I've done over the years. This video is sponsored by Alif Objects Inc., a free software, Libre innovation, and open source hardware company headquartered in Loveland, Colorado, USA, and makers of Lulzbot desktop 3D printers. Watch my reviews of both Lulzbot 3D printers here, and check the links in the video description for more info on these machines straight from Alif Objects. If you thought this video was helpful to you nonetheless, give it a thumbs up. If not, let me know what I can improve down in the comments below. Also consider subscribing to the channel, and because YouTube only really shows you update from the channel if you also check that bell, remember to also do that. Or if you want to support this channel with a spare dollar or two, head over to Patreon and get access to monthly Q&A hangouts and more. And that's it for today. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next one.